Very quickly, this is a process we follow. I'm not going to read each of these separately, but I would suggest if you're going to go down this path to consider an inside transaction, particularly one involving family members. To begin with, you better have some alignment on what it is you want to do and not just one person. You got to have some alignment of other shareholders, other family members. You know, what is the game plan? How are we going to do it? Who's going to be owners? Who's going to be involved? Make sure you've got some like-mindedness about the goal, right? Because if you don't have that, where you do a lot of work, and it's not all going to flow together. Capacity of the company, to the gentleman's point, is the next thing we would do, is to scrub the numbers pretty hard, look at the company's debt structure, look at what it can handle in terms of cash flow, understand those numbers very carefully. Evaluation of the senior generation's liquidity needs. We typically don't do that, at least right now, but we make sure that that gets done. We do some valuation work, okay? Often, again, to the gentleman's point, it's related to the capacity because you're scrubbing the numbers, but we'll do some range of value calculations, common multiples, things like that. Then we'll evaluate those methods. Remember that chart with all those different things at the bottom, ways to do it. Think about different structures that might work. And as part of that, we evaluate the tax structure because we're looking at, if you're going to do an inside transaction, you want to look at what you're going to end up with net of tax. Right, so some transactions can be very powerful tax-wise, some can be very inefficient. Next, we'll evaluate whether we can finance any of it. Sometimes, not often, if the company's balance sheet's strong enough, we can borrow some of this from a bank. It's not common to borrow all of it, but sometimes you can borrow some of it. ESOP transactions often involve bank borrowing, right? So we want to look at the financial alternatives in terms of how much you can borrow and where the debt should be. And then lastly, and this is one that people often do not get to or they don't realize, but if you think about it, particularly in a private company, when you have a transaction that where you've transferred ownership to, let's just say, from a mother and father to three kids, you get all this work done, right? Well, now those three kids are partners. The day that that's all done, parents are out, and now you got three kids that are partners. You better get that buy-sell agreement signed when you do the transaction. Because, you start this new ownership structure with three people that are partners. And some people say, I'll get to it later. Yeah, get to it later is a big problem here. While you're doing all the financial analysis, while you've got everybody at the table, we always make sure that at the closing of these transactions on these transfers, the buy-sell agreement is part of that and gets signed by the new partners so that they have very clear understandings about the financial arrangements, about how they're going to deal with each other. Not getting to this until later can often be a problem. So 5 years go by and there's no buy-sell agreement, and now one of the three kids says, I thought it was worth X, or I want to get my money this way. It's best before the transfer happens that you clarify the way the new partnership arrangement is going to work with the new shareholders. Don't do it later. This is on this slide because when I first started doing this, it wasn't. And I learned a hard lesson of not getting that done at the time we got the transfer done. You want to get that buy-sell agreement for the new partners signed at the table when the transfer takes place, so there's clarity about their business arrangements.